Welcome to Narc Abuse No More, where we're here to help educate you about narcissistic abuse, because your feelings do matter. Hi, and welcome to Narc Abuse No More with your host, Dr. and Evangelist K.O. Rich. Thanks for tuning in today. Today is Friday, November the 26th of 2021. I pray that you've had a blessed, stress-free, narcissistic-free, abuse-free week so far, and that the remainder of this week will continue to be so as well. But if not, we're going to be talking about a few things today. Again, my name is Dr. K.O. Rich with Narc Abuse No More, where we're here to help you admit what you feel in order to heal from the effects of narcissistic abuse, because your feelings do matter. Yes, they do. But before we go on with today's website, today's podcast, I want to invite you to our website at www.narcabusenomore.org. Again, that website address is www.narcabusenomore.org, or you can type in narcissisticabusenomore.com. Again, that's narcissisticabusenomore.com. And on our website, you'll find valuable information regarding narcissism, regarding relationships. We're going to be updating some things, because this 2022, Lord willing, we're going to be adding some blogs. We're going to be just having some other things that we plan on doing throughout the year. Also, as a reminder, and for those who are joining us for the first time, thank you for joining us. We will be coming on an extra day. That's right. We will be changing our schedule to Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. That's Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. So you're going to get, instead of 2 days a week, you're going to have 3 days a week. Now, the great thing is, we depending upon what podcast or what platform you're listening to us on, should I say, you can listen to us at the time of your choice. So even though we air at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, you can listen to us at the time of your choice. So we're on SoundCloud, or iHeartRadio, Spotify, Spreaker, Google Play, iTunes, Deezer, CastBox, and Amazon Audible. So if you have Amazon Audible, you can listen to us from there and at the time of your choice. So whether you're on a lunch break, whether you're cooking dinner for the kids, whether you're on your home or on your way home from work, you could just tune us in from there. Put us in your favorites and listen to us. All else fail, just go directly to our website at www.narcabusenomore.org. All right, how are you guys doing after Thanksgiving? I pray that you had a wonderful and blessed Thanksgiving. Oh, let me just tell you, I enjoyed my day. And it was very, very enjoyable, very peaceful. I had the chicken dressing and the smothered turkey wings and what else? A potato salad. And, you know, I made this cream cheese blackberry cake. It's a cream cheese blackberry cake. If you're following me on Facebook, you want to go and get a look at that picture. Oh, it was so good. I can't eat like I used to. My stomach get full faster. I wish my body weight would go down faster. But the thing is that I was so full. I just had a nice little serving. And I also had just half a slice of that cake. Because I like, when I make my cakes, I like to make them tall. I like three layers, okay? Three layers, icing in between. And I make these big, nice, tall cakes. I'm talking about homemade. Ain't nothing boxed. Homemade cakes. And they are scrumptious. But anyway, I pray that you had a wonderful Thanksgiving, and guilt-free. That's right, guilt-free. And that's what we're talking about today. We're talking about recognizing guilt trips that people use on you. We know narcissists love to have a lot of tools in their arsenal, and one of the things that they use is guilt trips. They love to guilt trip you to manipulate you into what they want you to do. And it is not for your benefit, it is for theirs. And so today we're going to www.learning-mind.com. Again, that's www.learning-mind.com. And the title of their article is A Guilt Trip is a Feeling. That's not the title of the article. What is a guilt trip and how to recognize if someone is using it on you? How to recognize a guilt trip? And the thing is, sometimes when narcissists, when they try to manipulate you, it's in subtle ways. That's why you have the overt narcissist, which is very obvious, and the covert that does it undercover, all right? But both types will use guilt trips in order to induce you to doing something that they want you to do, and it's a form of manipulation. Now, one of the things I disagree with regards to this particular article is they don't label it as psychological abuse. However, I tend to disagree with that. It's very much psychological abuse because they are psychologically manipulating you, and it helps to diminish your confidence. It diminishes your self-esteem. It manipulates you into doing a type of behavior that you would not ordinarily do, but because of their guilt tripping manipulative tactics, then you sometimes will go ahead and do something even if it's something that you don't feel comfortable doing. So that's very much psychologically abusing you. But we're going to go into some signs that someone is guilt tripping you, because you might say, well, it's obvious if someone is causing you to have a guilt trip, but some people do not know when someone is actually manipulating them. And therefore, this is why we talk about these things on this particular platform, in order to help validate what you are feeling. So number one, you feel like you're always disappointing someone or this particular individual, this narcissist in your life. You feel as if you can never do anything right. You can never do anything to please them, no matter how much you try. That person is always guilt tripping you into feeling like you're not good enough. You're not meeting their standards. There's something wrong with you. Why can't you get it right? Why can't you please me? And you can jump through hoops and bounds. But let me just say this to validate what you're feeling is if you're always trying to please an individual and nothing you can ever do will please them, that is disappointing. All right. So they are guilt tripping you into feeling like there's nothing you can ever do to please them. And guess what? When you're dealing with an individual like that, there's absolutely nothing you can do to please them, because they will always set the bar up higher, and it's never meant for you to meet it. So therefore, when you are constantly trying to run this marathon with this person, you're trying to meet, you know, you're trying to get to the end of the finish line. There is no finish line when you're dealing with a manipulative narcissist. They will guilt trip you into thinking that it's something wrong with you, and you're always short of the mark, and you can never meet the mark. That is guilt tripping. Number two, everything you do is your fault. Everything that goes wrong is your fault. They want to blame you for everything. As we know, that narcissists never take responsibility for their own actions. They attribute their bad behavior to you or to someone else. They will guilt trip you into taking the blame for their bad actions, for their bad decisions. They will guilt you into taking the blame for it, saying that you didn't do this for them, or you didn't do that for them, or if you had come through on this, or if you had come through on that. They will never take responsibility for what they do wrong. They will always find a scapegoat to place the blame on. So you will find yourself feeling that everything is your fault because that's what they want you to do as part of their guilt tripping process. Everything is their fault. If they don't succeed in life, it's your fault. If they fail on a project, it's your fault. If they mess up relationships, it's your fault. Everything is always your fault. They never take responsibility. And even if they verbally say, well, I'll say I did this, but it's always going to be a but. It's always going to be someone else's fault. Number three, you are constantly being compared to other people who are better. This is another form of guilt tripping. You always compare to someone else. Well, you need to be like this person and you need to be like that one. And my ex, and let me just say this, if you are in a relationship where someone is always comparing you to their former partners, that is not a healthy relationship. You should never be guilted into being something or someone else. If you are being compared to, well, my ex used to do this and my ex used to do that, then why aren't you with your ex? Because they're an ex for a reason, and it might be that they exed you out. Okay. All right. So you do not want to be compared to people of their past. It makes you feel like you're useless, like you're unworthy, like you're no good at anything. And they use this as a form to make others to make you feel like others are more intelligent. Others are better at their job. Others are better in the relationship. Others are more considerate. And you will never, again, you will never meet up to their standards because it's not meant. And the thing is, if everything was all gravy with the person that they're comparing you with, why aren't they with that person? Or they might be comparing you to another relationship. Well, look at how they are over there, and look at, there are no two relationships the same. And maybe if they weren't so busy comparing your relationship to someone else's relationship, then maybe, just maybe, you all could get along and work out your own relationship so that you can be on the right track. So again, this is another part of the conditioning mindset of guilt tripping you into feeling as if you're useless, you're unworthy, you're not capable of meeting their standards. Number four, you find yourself agreeing to certain conditions even if you really don't agree with them. They will guilt trip you into agreeing to things that you really don't feel comfortable with. And when someone does that, something is wrong, all right? If you're in a relationship and there's things in that relationship that you don't agree with, rather it's going to a certain relative's house on the holidays or just anything, and you find yourself, they're guilting you into feeling as if something's wrong with you and they will not operate in this relationship as they should, or would not give their all in this relationship unless you meet certain conditions. And I'm not talking about if somebody is an alcoholic, if they're drinking, you're saying, you know what, I'm not going to stay in this relationship unless you put the bottle down. I'm not talking about something like that. I'm talking about just being manipulative into saying that unless and you comply with my demands, then I'm not gonna give you X, Y, and Z, or I'm not gonna put my all into this relationship, or you're expected to, for example, do all the housework and no complaint at all while they go do whatever they want to do and never pitch in to help or anything like that. You do not want to be in manipulative relationships where you're having to agree to certain conditions in order for them to do their part in the relationship. That is guilt tripping. That is manipulation. And this can also deal with sexual issues. Well, unless you do X, Y, and Z, I'm going to deny you, you know, intimacy. I'm going to deny you conversation. I'm going to deny even acknowledging you as being my spouse. This manipulation, this type of guilt tripping can go into various areas. And when this happens in a relationship, it is a very toxic relationship, to say the least. No one should be guilt tripped. No one should be manipulated in a relationship. Relationships calls for communication, two adults talking to each other, telling each other what the things that they that will make them happy in the relationship. Not yelling, not screaming, not demanding, not being manipulative, not doing something under coercion. But two people coming together because they want the best in their relationship, because they love one another. All right, we're going to take a quick break and we'll be back in just a moment.
You can design more engaging marketing assets in no time at all, thanks to our AI-powered creative assistant.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping at your nose. Yuletide carols being sung.
That is The Christmas Song by Michael Bolton. All right, so continuing on. Number five, your love for a person is always under examination. Your love for a person is always under examination. When you're dealing with someone who loves to guilt trip you, when you're dealing with narcissists, they will always say things, or sometimes say things, if you love me, you would, or if you cared about me, you wouldn't. And this is a way of guilt tripping you. Now, again, there's always exceptions to this. If you would tell someone this in a case of, if you love me, you would not drink alcohol and drive. Okay, that is for their safety, their benefit, as well as you not wanting that person to harm themselves and your relationship with them. But when you're dealing with someone who is doing this out of pure manipulation, it's always, unless you do what I say, then you're gonna withdraw your affection, your attention, your dedication, your supposed loyalty to this relationship. So they want to induce a sense of guilt to control you, manipulate you, and manipulate others. Number six, the narcissist acts like they are a martyr because of you. They have fallen on their sword because of you. They act as if everything they do is for someone else, and they get no satisfaction at all by inducing these feelings of guilt. So therefore, they act as if they're self-sacrificing. Everything they did was for you. It was a real burden to put up with you. And what this does is this, again, it deals with it lowering your self-esteem. It makes you feel that you are not worthy of this individual. Oh, how dare you have your own mind? How dare you do anything without their approval? Because after all, they gave everything up for you, and they threw themselves on their own sword because of you. Now, manipulators love to use this as they're the victim, as they're the martyr. They have been through the fire to do something for you. And in actuality, when you do something for another person and sacrifice for another person, you do it because that's what you want to do, and because you're trying to help someone, not as a form of manipulation, not as something that you're going to be thrown up in their face later on. It's because that's what you wanted to do. But when you're dealing with manipulators, when you're dealing with narcissists, when you're dealing with toxic people, they will always act as if they're the victim, and you're somehow doing something to them to make them feel as if they need to pull out the martyr card. Because after all, if you don't do things the way that they want you to do, then they have at that point become a martyr for you. Number seven. You don't feel as if you can say no. I often say on this broadcast is that you need to have no in your arsenal. No should become comfortable for you when it's something that makes you uncomfortable. Oftentimes, codependents tend to want to be people pleasers, and they'll say no even if it's something that makes them feel insecure, uncomfortable, that they it compromised their standards, they don't agree with, because they don't want to hurt somebody, they don't want someone to be mad at them. But when you're being guilt tripped, be on high alert, because they'll make you feel as if you have done something wrong just because you say no. And then you wind up agreeing to things that you normally would not have done or dismissed. We tell children, teenagers, don't submit to peer pressure. But how often as adults we submit to peer pressure by narcissists and different ones just because we're afraid of what they might say or what they might think, or not wanting to be in our circle? Or and let me just say this. If a person is going to walk out of the relationship because you say no, then guess what? They weren't committed to that relationship anyway. So you don't want them to feel as if you have no backbone and not able to say no. Sometimes you have to say no. And when it's something that is uncomfortable for you, inconvenient for you, doesn't make you feel good, goes against what you believe in, you have an absolute right to say no and not feel guilty about it. And if someone wants to guilt trip you, you have to have that made up in your mind that, you know what, there's nothing that you can say or do that would make me feel guilty because I have the right to say no. See, when you're dealing with narcissists, no is in their vocabulary, but they feel as if nobody else can say no. They can always say no to whatever it is that they feel, but let someone else turn the card, flip the script, and say no to them, they can't handle it. So therefore, they will guilt you into thinking that you've done something wrong. You've committed an unpardonable sin when you say no to them, and that is not true. Number 8, this leads us into our next one. You feel obligated all the time to please. You feel as if unless you agree to their manipulation, then you would not be doing a just service to this person. And this messes with your psyche. You feel like you're always on the wrong side. You're always doing something wrong and you have to please them. So if you don't do exactly what they want, when they want, how they want it done, then you will never be on the good side of this individual. That is guilt tripping. It is manipulation. And it is you're dealing with someone that is toxic. You do not have to deal with people always on their terms when they want, when you're dealing with toxic individuals. It's sometimes people, for example, they may get upset because you don't they call you and you don't have time to talk, or you don't call them back when they think you should. Well, guess what? I'm on a schedule too. I have things to do too. So therefore, if I don't call you back right away, if I don't call you back in a certain time frame or whatever the case may be, it could be that I'm busy. I got things going on and I'm not able to drop things just because you feel like I need to pick up the phone and call. And you have people that want you to dance to their beat when they hit the drum. And the thing is that you have a right to say no. I don't have to people please just because you feel that I should move right when you think I should move. That is toxic, is unhealthy, and is unstable for my emotional health. This is what you have to tell yourself. Because people that are controllers, manipulators, narcissists, they feel as if the world centers around them. Everyone evolves around them. They're the center of the universe, and you have no right to your independent needs and wishes and desires because it's all about theirs. But when you get out of the people-pleasing mode, then you can say, you know what, I have to do some things that will benefit me. And I can't always look for someone else to be in agreement with my decision. But as long as you're comfortable with your decision, then that's what matters. And what am I saying here? This is not about selfishness. This is about sometimes you just have to say no to people who would never put you first on their list. Sometimes you have to say no and just say, you know what, I love you, but I love you from a distance. Sometimes when you're dealing with toxic individuals, you have to take yourself out of the equation because they are emotionally unhealthy. That means that I'm not going to say yes every time you want me to jump. I'm going to think about some things. I'm going to sit back. I'm going to evaluate. And if it's not beneficial or if it's something that I don't agree with, then I am not obligated to please. And this is so important for those who have been used, manipulated, or codependent of narcissists. We're going to take another quick break and we'll be back in just a moment.
It's Peacock's movie binge mystery. Lots of movies on your list.
With so many movies to watch, you can stream something new every day during Peacock's Movie Bingemas.
Mary Did You Know by Pentatonix, if I'm pronouncing that right. Pentatonix, Mary Did You Know. All right. So number nine, you feel you are needed and irreplaceable to your partner. This means that they cannot survive without you by their side. And you feel like, well, if I don't do what they want, or if they make you feel like, hey, you're irreplaceable to them. And this is not to say that they are not to value you, but they make you feel as if you're the only one that, and if you don't do what they want, then it's a great loss. And it's a form of manipulation. It's not a compliment. It's a form of manipulation. And so therefore they act as if you don't do whatever it is that they want you to do, then you're going to be causing them great harm, physical harm, emotional harm. And this could be someone that's using it for their benefit. And maybe in some ways they even use it, even if it's a way that it could be true on some level, but it's not all the way true if they have someone else who can help them. So again, you feel as if you are needed and irreplaceable to that particular person, and it's not that they couldn't get someone to fill in, but they make you feel that way as if you're going to do great harm to them if you do not do whatever it is that they're trying to manipulate you into doing. This is when you have to consider all options, you have to think about things, you have to evaluate the situation. And if it's something that's uncomfortable for you to do, or you're not able to do it, then say, okay, how can I go about not allowing this to cause me harm? And at the same time, if you have to help this person, meet the needs of that individual without feeling as if you are doing them some great injustice. And number 10, you have to overcompliment that individual again and again. People that are insecure, they never get enough compliments. Those that are narcissists, you always having to reassure them of themselves. Now, they won't give you the same, but you're always having to reassure them because their self-esteem is in the dumps, but it can also play with yours as well. So, you know, we all like compliments. We all like, you know, every now and then a little flattery. However, when you forced to have to reinforce somebody's worth, their self-esteem, then it becomes overboard. Someone that does not feel good about themselves, and you having to always reassure them, yes, you look nice, yes, you're smart, yes, you're intelligent, yes, you're this, you're that, you're that, and you feel like I'm always having to reassure this person, that is a sense of guilt tripping. It's also a sense of manipulation, because you're always making someone feel as if they have to reassure you when that person should be reassuring themselves that they are capable of doing whatever it is that they are either trying to do or just feeling good. You cannot see, the thing is, you cannot make someone feel good about themselves. You cannot even, no matter how many compliments, no matter how much you tell them, they have to have that on the inside of you. And when they make you feel as if you are constantly having to praise them, constantly having to reassure them, constantly having to key in on their insecurities in order to make them feel good, then that is manipulative and is guilt tripping you. And that's emotionally toxic and it's emotionally burdensome. So if someone is having trouble with their own self-esteem issues, then that's their issue. It's nothing that you can do. You can say, hey, you look nice, you look lovely, but until they feel it within themselves, you can say it till the cows come home and it will still never set in, because they have to have that on the inside of them. The thing is, you can do things nice for people, but you can't make them happy. You could bring a smile to their face, but you can't make them happy. Happiness comes on the inside of them. Yes, people might say, oh, they made me so happy because they gave me a gift. But what if that person was not able to give you a gift? Would you still be happy? Is there some joy on the inside of you? Because after the high of that gift has worn down, or you still happy on the inside? Happiness has to come from within. You know, the Bible tells us that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And we have to have the joy of God. And if you do not have the joy of the Lord on the inside of you, no matter what someone does on the outside, you would never be happy, truly happy within. And this is why so much pressure is put on those that are codependents and other people from narcissists, because on the inside, even though they may appear to be the epitome of happiness, they're not. They have empty holes, something that needs to be filled. And until they get that, they will never truly be happy. And that cannot come from an outside individual. It has to come first from God and then within. All right, we are up out of here. I pray that you've had a blessed and wonderful day today and that this podcast has been a blessing to you. And I pray that you have a blessed weekend. Until next time, this is Narcissistic Abuse No More with Dr. K.L. Rich. You be blessed.